Good morning, friends, and welcome to Trinity United Methodist Church this morning for worship. My name is Pastor Sarah, and I'm the pastor here, and I'm pleased to greet you and glad you're with us. If you're joining us by radio, you're going to have to shout hallelujah to God this morning. I can't hear you, but God knows you're with us. If you're on Facebook, you can like, you can love, you can share, you can say good morning. If you're on YouTube, you can also give us a thumbs up this morning. I'm just glad that you've chosen to join us and pray that this time of worship together will be a blessing. I have a few announcements to share with you this morning. One of the first ones is this coming week, I am going to go on an adventure of delivering some Bibles to our second and third graders. This week, for years, we've been giving Bibles to third graders as they've been going into third grade. And this year we're going to add the second grade class so that from here on out we'll be giving Bibles to second graders, because young people learn to read now much earlier than I did when I was a kid. So you second and third graders, you'll be getting a call from me this week for me to deliver your Bible to you. So look for that. Also, I want to share with you that this past week, I had the privilege of welcoming some people into membership and baptizing in our church. I baptized Peggy Bird, Larry Bird, and Andy Bird this past week, and Peggy has joined the church, and she is now an official member, though she's been attending here for quite some time. And then also, I want to celebrate with Hannah Sick and with AJ, because they have been baptized as well into the faith. Hannah was already a member here as well, but somehow these details, you know, they get lost sometimes along the way. So I'm grateful for the opportunity to baptize those two as well. So I'm sharing that with you because I know that all of you want to share in celebrating with those five people who are now baptized and have professed their faith in Jesus Christ. What a wonderful thing to be able to look back on this time of pandemic and remember the places where God drew close to us and reminded us that God was at work in powerful ways. Well, I don't know about you, but I am excited to be in worship today. I'm excited to be a part of this time, and I'm excited to hear what God will have to say to each of us and to see what God will do with the messages, with the scriptures, and with all the music and elements that come together to bring this worship to you. So God bless you. Let's join together in the call to worship. One of our new confirmands, Riley Welch, will lead us.
Join me in the call to worship. The heavens are telling the glory of God, and the firmament proclaims his handiwork.
The law of the Lord is perfect, reviving the soul. The decrees of the Lord are sure, making wise the simple.
The precepts of the Lord are right, rejoicing the heart. The commandment of the Lord is clear, enlightening the eyes.
Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable to you, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer.
Everybody, I hope everybody's doing well this morning. Pastor Sarah this morning is going to start a series on the book of Matthew. Matthew is found in the New Testament, and she'll be sharing some stories from the book of Matthew. And this morning, I want to share a really special story with you that comes from the book of Matthew. It's when Jesus chooses his disciples. Hadley, how many disciples did Jesus have?
12,
right. Everywhere Jesus went, Hadley, people followed him, and they gathered to hear him preach, and they just really liked to hear what he had to say about God and his love. But Jesus chose 12 men to be his followers, to be able to tell other people about God's love, and they were called disciples, or some people call them apostles. He chose 12 ordinary men. They weren't the richest men in the country. They weren't the smartest men in the country. Some of them had done some things they probably shouldn't have done, but Jesus knew that they had good hearts, and he wanted them to follow him and learn all about God and about how to tell other people about God's love. So Jesus was walking along, and he was walking along the sea, and he looked out and he saw these two guys, and they were fishing. And their names were Peter and Andrew, and they were brothers, and they were casting out their nets into the water, catching fish, and they weren't doing too good. So Jesus walked up to them and he said, cast them nets out one more time. And Peter looked up at him and he said, I don't know why we're not catching anything. He said, well, try it again. So they did. They put their nets back out into the water, and guess what happened? They caught a bunch of fish. And the two disciples, Peter and Andrew, got a little afraid. They thought, what's going on? But Jesus told them, come with me. I want you to fish for people, fish for men. And Peter and Andrew dropped their nets, and they followed Jesus, and they were the first two disciples. Right down the road, they saw two more fishermen, and they were brothers. Their names were James and John, and they were the sons of Zebedee. And guess what their nicknames were? Sons of Thunder, because you know why? They had bad tempers. But Jesus thought, hey guys, I can use you to help me. So as they were preparing their net, Jesus started talking to them, and he said to them, hey guys, come follow me. I need you to help me tell others about God. And guess what they did? They left their boat and they went with Jesus. Then Jesus found Philip, and he invited him to come along too. Philip seemed to have a missionary heart. He liked to talk to large crowds of people. And Philip went right along, and he even went and found his friend Bartholomew. Sometimes people call him Nathaniel. And he told Nathaniel, Bartholomew, that he had found the one that Moses had wrote about that was going to be the Savior. And guess what Bartholomew did? He stopped what he was doing, and he went right with Jesus as well. And then Jesus found a man named Matthew, and Matthew Hadley was a tax collector. And people didn't like tax collectors very much because they did cheated people out of their money. But Jesus walked right up to Matthew at his desk, and he said, hey, Matthew, I need you. I need you to come help me. Matthew didn't even hesitate, Hadley. He dropped what he was doing, and he followed Jesus. And then he invited the other men to be his disciples. James, another James called James the Less because he was younger and smaller than the other James. Thaddeus, who was James's brother. And then Thomas, called Thomas to come follow him. Thomas had a lot of faith in his heart, but we learn later there was a story about Thomas. He was a doubting Thomas. Then Simon the Zealot, and that means he liked to fight. But Jesus knew that he could use him too. And finally, Judas. Judas was the treasurer of the disciples, and then later we learned that he betrayed Jesus. The disciples weren't perfect. They got mad, they had tempers, they spoke before they thought, kind of like me sometimes, right? At times they were impatient. They were not perfect. But no matter who they were or what they had done, they knew that they wanted to follow Jesus. And Jesus knew that they had a good heart. Can you show them the picture of the 12 disciples? For 3 years, these 12 men followed Jesus everywhere he went and listened to what he told. He taught them about the kingdom of God. They heard the parables that we know in the Bible. They heard it firsthand. They got to see the parables happen. Jesus wanted them to learn more about God, and God sent the Holy Spirit to help them learn to preach and teach and tell others about his love. And you know what? God wants us to be his disciples too. We can be disciples for God, can't we, Hadley? We can teach others about Jesus. We can tell others about God's love. So that's something I want you to think about this week. You may not see your friends anytime soon, but when you do, I want you to do that. Think about it and pray about it, that you can share God's love with others just like those 12 men do. Their names are Andrew, Bartholomew, James the Less, John, Judas, Matthew, Peter, Philip, Simon, Thaddeus, and Thomas. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, there are so many people in this world who need to hear about your Son, Jesus. Give us the courage and the strength to do our part. Help us to be loving disciples for you and share your love with others. Amen. Hope to see you next week, and be patient with those teachers this week, okay? Bye.
Holy God, so much of our daily lives have changed in these last months. just on Sundays, from gathering the church parking lot to never even leaving our homes, from the pew and the sunlight and the beautiful sanctuary to our favorite chair and our PJs. As the school year begins, we are even more aware of changes to our education system and adjustments that are being made at church, within businesses, and in our workplace. More and more, we hear of friends and family who are ill or who have died. And yet, in the midst of it all, we find you, O God. You have not changed. You are still with us, comforting us, encouraging us, equipping us, and calling us to serve you in new and creative ways. In the last several months, there have been more expressions of love and solidarity than ever before, from celebratory yard signs to birthday parades and longtime neighbors learning one another's names and sharing supplies. Graduates from high school and college and graduate programs have taken steps to move into the next phase of their development and been sources of leadership and strength for all of us. Every profession is stretching resources and thinking outside of the box to offer new and more comprehensive services. Churches have come together under the banner of serving those in need, and people are continuing to give as they are able to mission and ministry. God, you are still sending dreams and casting vision for loving our neighbors and caring for those with great needs, and we are amazed at how you have sustained us. God, you are faithful. You keep your promises, and you are holding us in the palm of your hand. So we pray for the sick, those who are lonely, and those who have needs. We pray for the servicemen and women. We pray for those who mourn. Hear us as we share our concerns with you out loud or in our hearts. Let us pray the prayer that Jesus has taught us, saying together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Matthew 4:18 through 22. As Jesus was walking beside of the Sea of Galilee, he saw two brothers, Simon called Peter and his brother Andrew. They were casting a net into the lake, for they were fishermen. Come follow me, Jesus said, and I will send you out to fish for people. At once they left their nets and followed him. Going on from there, they saw two other brothers, James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John. They were in a boat with their father Zebedee, preparing the nets. Jesus called them, and immediately they left their boat and father and followed him. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be with God.
Well, good morning again. I want to begin worship this morning by thanking everyone for their part in leading in worship this day. Thank you to each of you. Thank you to those of you who have gathered together for this time of worship. And thank you to our whole church for the way that you're continuing to serve God, the way that you're continuing to give, the way that you're continuing to engage. I praise God for you daily, and I'm so grateful for the privilege of being your pastor. So thank you for all that you have done to stay connected in a time where it's easy to sort of drift away. Let's continue to lean into one another and to support one another, no matter what it is that we're in the midst of right now, that we are just a church that links arms and supports one another as best we can. So thank you for that. I hope you noticed this morning that in the call to worship, we said together the prayer from Psalm 19, which I generally begin each sermon with. And so I invite you this morning, if you'd like, to join me in this prayer as we begin. Oh God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be pleasing in your sight. Oh Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. This week we're beginning to get to know Simon Peter, the disciple Simon, or Peter as many call him and as we often call him. Peter was the kind of number one disciple. He was the leader of the rest of the disciples, and there's a lot to learn about Peter. He's a very human guy, and he's easy to connect with for that reason. It's fascinating to lean into what Peter has to say and do, especially in light of Jesus. And so these next few weeks, we'll be learning some more about Peter, but I thought this week we'd begin with Peter's calling experience, where Jesus is walking along and sees two brothers fishing, Peter, Simon Peter, and his brother Andrew. It kind of brings me to my first thought of the day. Are you a good volunteer? When someone gets up on stage and says, I need a volunteer, is that you? Are you that person that jumps and raises your hand and offers to volunteer? Well, I'll go ahead and begin by saying that is not me. I do not like to volunteer for things that I don't know. I don't like to volunteer, especially if I think it's gonna be something that might embarrass me or be a little crazy. Now, I am kind of pro embarrassing myself as long as I know what's coming, but not knowing is not my way. Now, I'm gonna step out on a limb here and say that our youth minister here, Tyler Neese, he's that guy. He's the kind of guy that when some person says, I need a volunteer, Tyler is raising his hand up and jumping out of his seat to volunteer and get up there. I think that's a pretty safe assumption to make about our Tyler. But I'll say this morning, as I lean into Peter's story, I'm not sure which type of person Peter is. You know, as we learn more about Peter, I begin to think that Peter might be that sort of jump in head first kind of person. But in this initial story, it's not really clear whether Peter is the kind of person that just jumps into the fray because he wants and longs to be a good volunteer, or if Peter is the kind of person that hangs back to wait and to see, to wait to be called on. Now, it's highly likely that Jesus is pretty notorious at this moment in time, and so Peter and Andrew have heard of Jesus, and they've heard about what Jesus is up to, and Peter and Andrew are good Jewish men. They long to see Israel reestablished and long to no longer be under the thumb of the Romans. And so they're sort of anxious to jump in to something which might lead them to a more free society and a better day in their mind. So there's that. They have definitely heard of Jesus. But there's also a good bit of unknown about this Jesus, about exactly what Jesus is calling them to. These fishermen, which Jesus calls out and says, come with me, I'll make you fishers of people. Fishers of people. Now, growing up, we would always say fishers of men, and that was kind of a play on the word fishermen becoming actual fishers of men, not men who happen to fish. But it also occurs to me that there might even be a deeper message here, because in our baptism, which Jesus called us all to do, we go through water. Water. Fishers of people, people who are baptized into the faith. I don't know. I don't want to go too far down that one, but it is interesting to think about how all these things might just be even more interconnected than we realize. They are longing for something more. They're longing for something meaningful. They're longing for something else. And so when Jesus calls out to them and invites them into this something else, they step right out in faith. They step out knowing that whatever is coming, that fulfillment might just be on the horizon for them. They have no idea that Jesus is calling them to be part of a movement which literally turns the world on its head. It makes me think of a popular song here recently from the musical Hamilton, The World Turned Upside Down. They sing as Hamilton is a musical about Alexander Hamilton, and it's on the backdrop of the Revolutionary War. And so it's in this moment that the Americans, the colonists, have defeated Great Britain. Great Britain retreats home, and they sing this song, The World Turned Upside Down. The world turned upside down. Because no one saw that coming. No one saw a group of colonists being able to overturn Great Britain. And so this song drives that idea home that a surprise happened here. Jesus is inviting Andrew and Peter specifically, into the greatest surprise and greatest fulfillment of his life. Because Peter never could have anticipated all the things that would happen to him as a result of saying yes to Jesus on that day. Because Jesus invites Peter into a kingdom that turns on the powerful, a kingdom which lifts up the weak, a kingdom which comes alongside the vulnerable, a kingdom which heals those that the religious authorities have said are hurting because of the choices they've made. Jesus invites Peter into a world that God has made, where the hungry are fed, where the hurting are soothed, where the lost are welcomed home. Jesus invites Simon Peter to understand God as a God of redemption, a God of grace, a God of forgiveness, and most importantly, a God who longs to be with God's people. A God who longs to claim us as his own. As I said before, Peter could never have known in that very first moment when Jesus called out to him and his brothers all that the next 3 years of his life would bring. And beyond that, the next 2,000 years of Christians and people that would come into relationship with Jesus Christ because a guy named Peter said yes to fishing for people when notorious Jesus came along. It reminds me of a simple story, really, but one that has a beautiful ending. Of the very first church that I served that church with two other pastors. It was in downtown Knoxville, Church Street United Methodist Church. And one of the things that happened on a regular basis at that church was that we received calls from people who needed help. Help paying their rent, help paying any number of bills, help with food, help with gas, people who were in all kinds of need. Sometimes people would come by the church looking for that help, sometimes they would call, but it would be an all-day occurrence if we had the time and the space to help all the people that came looking for help. And so one day, as the pastors were talking about wanting to meet those needs and wanting to provide all the help that we could and yet also feeling overwhelmed by it, one of my colleagues said out loud, "What if we established an official benevolence ministry at this church?" And we asked lay people in our church if they would meet with people and help figure out how to best meet those needs. If there were organizations we could connect them with, bills that could be paid, ways that we could make a difference in these people's lives, ways that we could keep up with them so that we could support them as they come across other needs that they have. And so it was a brilliant idea, and he ran with it and envisioned it and talked to others about it. And one of the things that we all prayed for was that God would reveal to us someone that could kind of take the lead of that ministry. There wasn't really anyone who was sticking out in a big way as someone who would have the time or the interest to take the lead on a ministry like that, though there were many people who volunteered and were wonderful volunteers. And so we prayed and we asked God to show us a person that would take the lead in that ministry. And my colleague, Daryl, he had this feeling that the person that was supposed to take the lead was a guy who sat on the right side, if you're facing the congregation, near to the back, sat there every week with his wife for worship. I'd barely spoken a couple of words with this man, but my colleague had had other conversations and felt as if this person might be someone who would feel called to do a ministry like this. And so he pulled him aside at the end of church one day and just said, "Hey, how would you feel about helping us organize this benevolence ministry?" And this man, this quiet man, said yes. And in the beginning, he said yes to organizing a benevolence ministry, but over time, that benevolence ministry reached out to countless families, serving them, meeting their needs. This man went over and above and beyond to train and empower volunteers. And then that turned into a ministry center, which included a food bank. And this man continued to do that work. The important part of this, and the important part of Peter's story, and the important part of the story that I just told you, was that in the beginning, there was a yes to follow God and to see what would come next. You, yes, you and me, each and every one of us are called by God. Each and every one of us are the catch. The catch. The catch which invites us to then respond to God's call. Now that might be in the way that you are called to parent the child that you have been entrusted with. It might be that you as a teacher are uniquely called and put in a position to come alongside a child that no one else has seen potential in. It might be that at your workplace, God nudges you to speak up and to speak out on behalf of others. It may be that in our community, God is nudging you to speak to truth and justice and to do so with love and grace. It may be that God is calling you to advocate on behalf of someone else. It may be that God is calling you to full-time ministry. It may be that God is calling you to say yes to a volunteer opportunity at church, or pushing you to share a resource that might make all the difference in the world. Friends, we have no idea what God will do with the initial yes, like Peter gave. We have no idea where God will take us. But I can tell you that we can trust in the yes, because I promise you, it will all become clear within time. Thanks be to God. Amen.